Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today I want to first start by saying thank you for watching 5 Minutes of Postgres. This is episode 100, and over the last almost 2 years, it's been great every week to spend time looking at what's new with Postgres or what are good best practices that are still relevant today. On that last thought, today I want to talk about something that is very relevant, even though the post that we'll start with is back from 2018. We'll start with this post by Sean Thomas on the Second Quadrant blog. In this blog post, Sean describes how you can use column ordering in Postgres to optimize the amount of space a table takes on disk. After that, we'll also talk a bit about different storage techniques, such as using arrays to use toast, that can help you make up to a 5x improvement of how much data your tables take on disk. Now let's start with using the pgColumnSize function and manually constructing rows. The smallest possible row in Postgres is 24 bytes. That's just a tuple header without any additional information. When I add a data point such as small int, you'll see that small int takes 2 bytes, so I have 26 bytes total. When I add a big int, that's 8 bytes, so that's 32 bytes. Now what's surprising, and this is really what Sean's article here is about, is if I have a row where first I have a small int, and then I have a big int, you would expect it to be 10 bytes, right? So we would expect it to be ultimately 34 bytes of total storage for this row, but we're actually getting 40 bytes. What happens is that small int takes 2 bytes, then there's 6 bytes of padding, and then there's another 8 bytes for that big int, and this is how we end up with a 40-byte row. Now, this, of course, gets worse if you have more complex real-life workloads where your tables grow over time, people add new columns, and so you'll actually end up having a mix of data types in your columns in a particular table. Here, for example, when we look at this internally, how Postgres stores this is that, for example, here we have a Boolean, then we have an int 8, this mix of different types. For each of these types, Postgres stores information in its internal PG attribute table with the type align column and the type length column. So type align is essentially which alignment boundary it aligns on. And then the type length is how long that type is in bytes, or if it's a variable length field, then it would be -1. So a text, for example, might take just a few bytes, might take 100 bytes. It really depends on how much data is being stored. Now, what Sean illustrates here is that the ordering of your columns can have a pretty drastic impact on the size of the table. With this test case, we generate a bunch of data. In this case, just using the current ordering of the columns, we get 135 megabytes table. That's the baseline. That's what we want to improve on. Really, what we're trying to do here is we're trying to group things together so we don't have that padding that Postgres would add otherwise. So I'll just pick one example here. Let's imagine you have two integers. Those are each 4 byte size, and then a big int is 8 byte in size, and so it makes more sense to do integer, integer, big int instead of integer, big int, integer. You usually want to have your smaller data types clustered together and then your larger data types following that, and so we can play column Tetris to make that all fit together in an optimal form. That's what Sean does here by ordering all the data types by their length. With the optimized order, we get down from 135 megabytes to 112 megabytes. Right? So we already save 20% of the space just by reordering columns. And that's a really nice benefit. I want to point out that the term column Tetris was not coined by Sean initially. Aaron Brandstetter had used this term many years ago on Stack Overflow, describing the exact same technique, and I'm sure other people have also invented that. Aaron also had another good point where he responded to somebody reading Sean's post and clarifying something about how variable length fields are treated. This is a bit of a complex story, but just to say, if you have a lot of variable length fields, like a text field, the best practice usually is to put them at the end. You put your fixed size types first, and then you have your text follow after that. But Aaron actually described that there are edge cases where it actually makes sense to do an ordering like integer, text, small int. He also references a good utility here, which is called pgColumn Byte Packer. If you're really trying to squeeze things and you don't want to do this work manually, James Coleman and the team over at Braintree maintain pgColumn Byte Packer, which is intended for use with Ruby and Rails in particular. And so you can use this to automatically optimize your columns in Active Record migrations. So this is mostly useful in creating new migrations, or also optionally, it can resort an existing structure. Sometimes there are larger improvements to be had by adjusting your data structure. I want to briefly talk about a post that describes this a little bit by Joe Conway from a couple of years back. So in this blog post, Joe talks about a use case where there's two different tables. One table is storing the parents, and then there's multiple details for each of those parent records. What Joe explores in this post is an alternate storage of that structure. He starts out with 1.1 gigabytes, and then he tries different variants. And I think the most important thing that he tries here, which I found really interesting over the years, and we've recently had great success with this at pganalyze, is array-based storage. Instead of having multiple records, each of them with data point, what if we can combine them into an array and we store an array in Postgres? And so in this particular example, Joe had a 13% reduction in storage by moving from the one row per value approach to storing this as an array. Sometimes you could actually get even bigger benefits. This array-based storage approach we've recently used for time series data. And there are other ways to store time series data, but I want to show you an example where using an array to store data is really great. We'll talk more about this in another 5 minutes episode or a blog post, but just a quick example here from our own database. So we have this information we store in our system for query stats, and we recently made an effort to use arrays for this. Historically, the way we stored this is we said, here's a particular query fingerprint, and here's how many calls that fingerprint had at a particular point in time. This, for one day worth of data in the current system, is about 112 gigabytes of data. Now, there's a lot more efficient ways to do this. And so what we ended up doing is using arrays for this. For a particular point in time, let's put multiple query statistics together in one. Instead of just storing one row being one value, we actually say each row is many values. And so the idea here is that the information becomes much more packed. This packed array style format actually had a drastic reduction in size. And so for us, we went from 112 gigabytes of data plus toast to 20 gigabytes of data and toast for the exact same data. The 5x improvement is a big change. And really the difference here is that when you use arrays in Postgres and they're long arrays and there's duplicate data in this, Postgres will move them to toast and Postgres will also use compression on them. And so if you have this type of data where you have very similar values that are being stored a lot, sometimes it's worth exploring this array-based storage technique that lets you pack data very efficiently without requiring any extensions in standard Postgres. So great opportunity in some workloads. For all the workloads, you could definitely benefit from thinking about column alignment. And for some workloads, using array-based storage will get you up to a 5x improvement. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.